Advent is about the birth of something sacred. For something sacred needs to be born, born from the mating of what is and what might be. It needs a manger. So let us prepare a manger in our hearts for the birth of the sacred. Hello and welcome to worship. My name is Susan Sheppard and I serve the pastoral charge of Belle Island and Portugal Cove here in Newfoundland and Labrador. And this is the fourth weekend of Advent. And we're going to be doing Advent 4. I'll send you another video for Christmas Eve. For thousands of years, Indigenous people have lived in this land on their own country. Their relationship with the land is at the center of their lives. And we acknowledge the Beothuk and Mi'kmaq people of this island and the Innu and Inuit people of Labrador and their stewardship of these lands throughout the ages. As settlers in these lands, we acknowledge our role in past and present wrongs. We mourn the laughter silenced and the lives robbed and not recorded. We will continue to learn and to do our part to live into the ways of reconciliation. We also endeavor to make this a safe place for all people to worship, regardless of racial or cultural background, creed, age, ability, nationality, economic status, sexual orientation, or gender identity. And now let's light our last Advent candle. On this fourth week of Advent, we light this candle symbolizing love. We come to lean into loving one another even when it's difficult. Jesus demonstrated that every person is worthy of our love, a flame of purpose that should not be extinguished. Love is most fully lived in relationships that are mutual, life-giving, and self-giving. We come learning how to love with kindness and compassion. We celebrate the good news embodied in love alive among us. And let us pray. Teach us, O God, to hear the cries of those impoverished. Show us how to care for others with loving kindness. Communicate with us so that we, too, may communicate the good news with love. Encourage us to move towards those who need us. Open our perceptions to discover Christ's face in one another, setting our hearts on fire with passionate self-giving. Amen. Our first hymn is number 12 in Voices United. She Walked in the Summer. She walked in the summer through the heat on the hill. She hurried as one who went with a will. She danced in the sunlight when the day was done. Her heart knew no evening who carried the sun. Fresh as a flower at the first ray of dawn, she came to her cousin whose morning was gone. There leaped a little child in the ancient womb, and there leaped a little hope in every ancient tomb. Hail, little sister who heralds the spring. Hail, brave mother, of whom prophets sing. Hail to the moment beneath your breast. May all generations call you blessed. When you walk in the summer through the heat on the hill, when you're one with the wind and one with her will, be brave with the burden you are blessed to bear, for it's Christ that you carry everywhere. Now, whether you take what is written in the Bible as fact, metaphor, myth, or story, listen to these words now for the meaning they hold for you on this day. And today's reading is from the Gospel of Luke, chapter 1, verses 26 to 38, and then 47 to 55. In the sixth month of Elizabeth's pregnancy, God sent the angel Gabriel to the Galilean village of Nazareth to a young woman engaged to be married to a man descended from David. His name was Joseph, and the young woman's name Mary. Upon entering, Gabriel greeted her. "Good morning. You're beautiful with God's beauty, beautiful inside and out. God be with you." She was thoroughly shaken, wondering what was behind a greeting like that. But the angel assured her, "Mary, you have nothing to fear. God has a surprise for you. You will become pregnant and give birth to a son and call his name Jesus. He will be great, be called Son of the Highest. The Lord God will give him the throne of his father David. He will rule Jacob's house forever. No end ever to his kingdom." Mary said to the angel, "But how? I've never slept with a man." The angel answered, "The Holy Spirit will come upon you, and the power of the Highest hover over you. Therefore, the child you bring to birth will be called the Holy Son of God. And did you know that your cousin Elizabeth has conceived a son, old as she is? Everyone called her barren, and here she is, 6 months pregnant. Nothing, you see, is impossible with God." And Mary said, "Yes, I see it all now. I'm the Lord's maid, ready to serve. Let it be with me just as you say." Then the angel left her. Mary then travels to visit Elizabeth. And Mary said, "I'm bursting with God news. I'm dancing the song of my Savior God. God who took one look at me, and look what happened. I'm the most fortunate woman on earth. What God has done for me will never be forgotten. The God whose very name is holy, set apart from all others. God, mercy flows in wave after wave on those who are in awe before God. God bared God's arm and showed God's strength, scattered the buffeting braggarts. God knocked tyrants off their high horses, pulled victims out of the mud. The starving poor sat down to a banquet. The callous rich were left out in the cold. God embraced God's chosen child, Israel. God remembered and piled on the mercies, piled them high. It's exactly what God promised, beginning with Abraham, right up to now." May these words help us to learn from the past and listen for God's word today.
Thank you.
here we are, the last part of last weekend of Advent. It also happens to be Christmas Eve. Do we rush into the Nativity story or linger with the Advent and the Annunciation? I say we stay with Advent and leave the birth narrative just a little while longer. Advent has been a time of preparing and waiting, but where is the good news in that? As I've said before, most of us are not very good at waiting. So that's why we're given the preparing part to go with the waiting. The preparing of Advent is in the looking for good news, in becoming aware of, more sensitive to, the moments of grace in us and in our ordinary daily events. Otherwise, we may miss what actually is in our longing for something else. This week's reading revolved around Mary. She is universally recognized with her eyes lowered, the infant Jesus in her arms, and located in a stable. Generally speaking, traditionally Protestants seem to have a bit of a hang-up about Mary. Or if not Mary, some of the more exaggerated traditions about her. But Mary is important. The writer of Luke does not provide us with many particulars of Mary's situation. There's no hint that she is sinless or immune to the perils of human life. From the little we know about her, she was an ordinary young girl, maybe as young as 12. She was probably the daughter of a peasant farmer who would have arranged her marriage. She is betrothed, or possibly married to, a much older man. But if you're 12, someone in their early 20s is much older. Then she finds herself pregnant. She lives in occupied territory, and during a worldwide demonstration of Roman imperial might under the oppressive authority of the divine savior, the Prince of Peace, Augustus. Luke uses historical information to set Jesus' birth in political time, when Herod the Great was king of Judea and Augustus was emperor. But he also sets the birth in relative time, 6 months after Elizabeth and Zechariah are told they will be parents, the angel appears to Mary. The announcement of Elizabeth's pregnancy. In the announcement of Elizabeth's pregnancy, the angel comes to Zechariah, an elderly man and priest in the temple. Zechariah has been longing for a child for years. If God were taking applications from people who were hoping for pregnancy, surely Zechariah and Elizabeth's application would have been near the top of the stack. Mary, on the other hand, she's unmarried, a young girl. She has not expressed any desire for a child, and the angel does not come to her with this good news in a sacred place such as the temple or a synagogue, but comes to her in Nazareth, a small rural village which doesn't carry the best of reputations. Remember the line, "Does anything good ever come out of Nazareth?" In the pile of applications for pregnancies, you would not find Mary's name because she didn't fill out an application. Mary trusts and seeks to serve. Zechariah wants proof. Mary asks how. Zechariah is fearful. Mary feels wonder. Mary says yes to this unexpected and potentially dangerous pregnancy. I wonder how many young girls said no before Mary said yes. Did she not submit? She did not submit or surrender. She made a choice. Mary's story offers a glimpse of how God moves in unexpected places and people. For years now, the battle has been raging of the historical factualness of a virgin birth. Whatever you choose to believe or not believe about the supernatural virgin birth or virgin conception, it should never be used to disqualify Mary's humanity or womanhood, or for that matter, Jesus' humanity or manhood. Frederick Buchner writes, "If you believe God was somehow in Christ, it shouldn't make much difference to you how God got there. If you don't believe, it should make less difference still." Luke tells us this story to give more status and honor to this ordinary young woman, which in turn gives even more honor and status and significance to Jesus. A child of Middle Eastern appearance whose life is at risk from the moment of his conception because of cultural and religious issues. And where's the good news? Not in the spectacular, the dramatic, the supernatural, but it's just where it always is, in us, in the ordinary us, in those like us and those not like us, in the ordinary way an ordinary person can be someone through whom something creative, sustaining, transformational enters anxious and stressful times. A quote from the book The Birth of Jesus for Progressive Christians by Donald Schmaltz says, Jesus came into the world in a normal way. He was conceived in a normal way and was born in a normal way. His upbringing was normal. He was just a normal guy, just like you and me. That's what's amazing. Jesus was like any of us. Jesus had some special talents, an ability to talk to a crowd, and a great speaker. But all of us have special talents. All of us do amazing things. Jesus was special because he recognized his talents and used them. Imagine if we all did that. Advent is rooted in our everyday experiences. With an incognito God prompting us to engage in meaningful life, love wastefully, and like Mary, be all that we can be. And let us pray. Loving God, throughout history, you have been active in this world, speaking, guiding, whispering, and nudging us to be the people you know us we can be. You have spoken through angels, messengers of your grace, justice, and love. You have spoken through prophets, the truth tellers of our world, who call us from self-interest to community, from human limitation to divine vision. You have spoken from our own flesh, embodying all that it means to be human. From your newborn cry to your final heartbroken words, you spoke to us of the abiding love and enduring covenant, which has never failed, no matter how often we have turned away. You have spoken, Holy One, throughout all generations. Help us to hear you speak to us now. Help us to take the ancient stories of our faith and learn from them as Mary did. Help us to reimagine the words of prophecy that still speak truth to our lives, that we might learn to respond to the enduring truth of your call. Help us to resist the temptations that have followed humanity since the beginning. May we set aside the idols of wealth and status, self-interest and self-importance. May we abandon the conceit that being made in the image of God means that God is just like us. Help us to reimagine what it might look like to say yes when we hear your call. To not focus on what might be hard, but rather on what might be made possible. Help us to carry you within ourselves. Help us to embody your holy love, so that it is not only our souls that magnify you, but our words and our deeds. Help us to remember that your incarnation continues as you dwell not within the buildings we construct, not in the church or the synagogue, the mosque or the temple, but within the very love of our hearts. Help us to say yes to you, God of grace. Amen. Please join me in the Abba Prayer, which is written in the spirit of the Lord's Prayer. Eternal Spirit, source of all that is and ever shall be, loving parent in whom we discern heaven, may knowledge of your holiness inspire all peoples, and may your commonwealth of peace and freedom flourish on earth until all of humankind heed your call to justice and compassion. May we find the bread that we need for today, and for the hurts we cause one another, may we be forgiven in the same measure that we forgive. In times of trial and temptation, help us to be strong. When life seems overwhelming, help us to endure. And thus from the yoke of sin deliver us, May you reign in the power of human love, now and forever. Amen. Our final song today is number 16 in Voices United, Mary, Woman of the Promise. Mary, woman of the promise, bearer of your people's dreams, through your open, willing spirit, waters of God's goodness streamed. Mary, song of holy wisdom, sung before the world began, faithful to the word within, you carried out God's wondrous plan. Mary, morning star of justice, mirror of the radiant light, in the shadows of life's journey, be a beacon for our sight. Mary, model of compassion, wounded by your offspring's pain, when our hearts are torn by sorrow, teach us how to love again. Mary, woman of the gospel, precious home for treasured seed, help us to be true disciples, bearing fruit in word and deed. And thank you for joining us for worship. And you'll get another email tomorrow for Christmas Eve. May the God who dances in creation, who embraces us with human love, who shakes our lives like thunder, bless us and drive us out with power to fill the world with her justice. Amen.